Hello, I'm Renton Laidlaw, and welcome to Hidden Links Golf Guide to Scotland. Now, who doesn't dream of one day teeing it up at St Andrews or walking down that 18th fairway over the Swilken Bridge in the footsteps of golf's greatest champions? But Scotland, you know, is much more than the home of golf. It's an entire kingdom devoted to the game. In Scotland, golf and everyday life are inseparable. The welcome and the hospitality afforded visitors is woven into the soul of the Scots, as you're about to discover. We'll tour all the Scottish classic courses. St Andrews, Turnberry, Muirfield, Royal Troon, and one of my favourites, Carnoustie. All of them cornerstones of the game, and all of them open championship venues. But we'll also head to the far corners of this golfing kingdom for special places that embody the very spirit of golf. Places like Macrahanish on the Mull of Kintyre, Royal Dornoch in the Scottish Highlands, and Cruden Bay in the shadows of the ruins that inspired the story of Count Dracula. But there's more to see than just the courses. We'll get an inside look at a wide array of old world accommodations, as well as some of the best 19th holes, with dozens and dozens of special malt whiskies to taste. So sit back and enjoy the wonderful golfing kingdom of Scotland. St Andrews is the birthplace of golf, where the game dates back as far as the 1400s. To golfers, this is a very familiar sight, the incomparable setting in the old grey toon. The famous old course is not private. It's open for play to not just the members of the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St Andrews, who recently celebrated their 250th anniversary, and for the members of other St Andrews clubs, but for any other golfer who dreams of playing at the home of golf. And what a feeling it is to finally place that tee in the ground for that opening drive. That's a frightening tee shot there. Everybody seems to be watching you through the window. And although the fairway at the first is a wide one because it's a joint one with the 18th, you still feel very nervous when you step on there. But to step on there and play the old course is magic. What a challenge lies ahead, beginning with the bunkers. 112 of them, to be exact. Nearly all have names, though you won't want to get to know them personally. There's this deep monster next to the third green called Cart Gate. The BADs must be avoided as you make your way back into town. And then there's Hell Bunker on the 14th. Every golfer's worst nightmare is to get in Hell Bunker. Even the great Jack Nicklaus took four shots from this spot in his way to a 10 in the 1995 Open.
When Tiger won here in 2000, he didn't once go into a bunker. I bet you'll not be quite so lucky.
The old course also has seven famous huge double greens with two holes cut on each. Interestingly, the double green holes always add up to 18, 2 and 16, 3 and 15, and so on. Three putts are always possible because, well, you might find yourself on the green all right, but 100 feet from the hole. Remarkably, John Daly didn't three-putt once when he won the Open in 1995. Perhaps the most famous hole in all of golf is the road hole, the 17th. The tee shot is hit directly over the recreated old railway sheds that guard the corner of the dogleg. As you walk around the sheds towards the town, two things will be on your mind. First, to stay out of the diabolical road bunker guarding the green. Secondly, and even more worrisome, to stay off the road itself, which runs behind the very narrow putting surface. No drops here from this road. The ball must be played as it lies, with unpredictable results. After you hit your final drive on 18, it's your turn to take the walk over the Swilken Bridge. Savour the moment, and don't go home without the photo, the one you'll always cherish, the one with the R&A clubbers in the background. Everyone gets a gallery on the 18th hole at the old course, giving you just one more moment of nervousness as you play up and hopefully through the Valley of Sin. Playing the old course is an incredible experience, and one that you shouldn't experience alone. Take a caddy to guide you. He'll help you plot your way around and, on the home stretch, point out the distant steeples that mark the perfect line. They say that not to take caddies on the old course is to miss the very wine of the country. They really are truly part of the experience.
I have 280 caddies here working at St Andrews, and we do something like 26,000 rounds between April to November. And the nearest anywhere to us in the world is perhaps Pinehurst, where they do about 10,000.
So how do you manage to book a round on the old course? It's easier than you might think.
The ballot we have for the old course is for a certain amount of times that we have to leave each day for any particular group to try and play who haven't booked in advance. So what we do is each day we fill out what we call our ballot cards. People either phone in or actually do it in person at our clubhouse receptions, and they give us the names, handicaps and the home clubs for the golfers and what time they want to play. Now this is a day ahead before procedure, i.e. if they wanted to play on a Tuesday, they do that on a Monday. Then we just do it as a draw. It's a complete random draw that one of my reservations team will pull out each day at 2:30, and then we'll post the draw for the next day's play around the town and on our website by 4 o'clock that day to let you know if you have been successful for the next day. And we're a public links facility here, so anybody is able to play, again, through the ballot procedures. You can be very unlucky if you're here, say, 3 or 4 days and you do not get a time on the old course.
One last way to get a tee time is to simply put your name in at the starter's hut. Dozens of people get out as singles most every day, and you could be lucky.
If you do not even get a time through the ballot, you're able to approach the starter on the day and try and join any other 2, 3 or 4 ball. Or there are even cancellations each day as well that you can actually get a game with.
If you aren't able to play the old course, St Andrews offers many other fantastic and historic courses not to be missed. The new course is new only in comparison to the old. It was designed by old Tom Morris and opened in 1895. The new plays over the same links land as the old, in the shadow of the same famous skyline. There are only a couple of holes in all of St Andrews that have water in play. The best is on the new. It's the long par 3 ninth by the Eden Estuary. The punchbowl green really is tricky. Next to the new is the Jubilee course, which dates back to 1897 and is named for the Diamond Jubilee of Queen Victoria's coronation. The Jubilee, which also has a trademark St Andrews double green, co-hosted with the old course the 2004 British Amateur Championship. On the other side of the old course is the Eden. It has all the little bumps so familiar to St Andrews and calls for equally imaginative shot making. Not as long or as difficult as the others, the Eden will still add to your enjoyment of playing at St Andrews. So where do you stay? Well, the options are many. There's the Old Course Hotel, for instance, a 5-star resort that sits right on the road hole. The view from upstairs is so grand, it was worthy of painter Graham Baxter's extensive canvas. The rooms are so comfortable, and the standard doubles will suit almost everyone. But those wanting something really special should consider booking a fairway suite. The Old Course Hotel has 2 superb restaurants, the Roadhole Grill on the top of the hotel, and the Sands Seafood Bar and Restaurant downstairs, both offering the finest in dining. There's a spa too, where you can ease those aching golf muscles. The oldest pub in St Andrews is on the property as well. That's the Jigger Inn, just over the stone wall from the road hole. It's quite famous in its own right. The Old Course Hotel even has its own golf club at the Duke's Course, built on parkland high above the old grey turn. It's a course with a view. It was designed by the Australian Peter Thompson, 5-time Open champion, and has a little bit of fescue and is a nice change of pace from the links. Oh, and by the way, you'll enjoy an excellent lunch here in the traditional clubhouse. Occupying an enviable location on the 18th fairway of the old course is Russick's Hotel, one of the most historic in Scotland. It pays homage to the game's greats who visited St Andrews over the years. Rooms are named after the St Andrews Open champions, such as the Jack Nicklaus Room, which overlooks the 18th tee and the road hole. At Russick's, you can dine while watching golfers playing up and down the 1st and 18th. And just a sand wedge from the old course's 18th green on the corner of Golf Place is another golfer's paradise, the Dunvegan Hotel. Here, not only are golfers welcome, their spikes are too. upstairs, the bedrooms are very comfortable, and this is one Scottish shower that's more than welcome. Downstairs at the Dunvegan, the Golfer's Corner Bar is the place for players and caddies to gather after a round. Over the years, a regular patron was Arnold Palmer's longtime Oaken caddy, the late Tip Anderson. And this was Tip's seat. Here he shared stories about the King most every night. Owners Jack and Sheena Willoughby cater to all sorts of famous personalities. Indeed, you never know who you will run into at the Dunvegan.
Most importantly, the people that come and visit us are the diehard golfers, people that golf on their vacations and that's their hobby. And then every now and again, we get the, the pros coming through. And the one common thing that we all have is that we all enjoy playing golf.
Even B&Bs in St Andrews are special. Right at the top of the list is Craigmore House. The bedrooms are pleasant, breakfasts are excellent, and guests get to meet Tommy, who's duked it out with the best. For something different, try the five-star Rufflets Country House Hotel, built in beautiful grounds. This is where Jack Nicklaus usually stays when he's in town. The stately rooms offer a luxurious atmosphere, and the cuisine has been awarded the prestigious Two Rosettes for several years running. Just outside the town is another great dining experience, the Grange Inn, where the atmosphere is sublime and the cuisine matches it. Not a place to miss if you're visiting on holiday. Close to the Grange is another fabulous golf resort, St Andrews Bay. It's home to two wonderful clifftop courses that offer you new views of the old Bray Toon. The Torrance course was designed by Sam Torrance, with some help from the late Gene Saracen. It plays high above the sea, but it has a links feel to it, with unforgettable bunkering like here at 17. The neighboring Devlin course, designed by the Australian Bruce Devlin, is a cliff-top stunner. It's simply spectacular. Beautiful St Andrews is never far from sight, and would you believe it, there's even a double green to remind you of the old course. There's a real sense of achievement at St Andrews Bay, where two fine courses have been created from what was once just farmland. The Bay, as it's called, is a friendly place where the clubhouse is a welcome sight. There's lots to talk about after you play here, and it's certainly worth considering a stay at the deluxe St Andrews Bay Resort. The rooms are as comfortable as you'll find in Scotland. Owner Don Pallas has thought of everything. Visitors from the United States don't even need their adapters because the plugs here are straight from home. Downstairs is a beautiful spa where relaxation is the order of the day, but you may be happiest in the bar, a perfect place to unwind after hopefully another great day of golf. You'll want to walk around through the grounds of the ruined 12th century cathedral and absorb the incredible history of the place. Then there's St Andrews Castle, which was the site of the 1306 coronation of Robert the Bruce in defiance of King Edward I. The British Golf Museum brilliantly recreates the development of the game. Interactive exhibits and impressive memorabilia make this a must-visit for any aspiring golf historian. St Andrews is also based for the only current working manufacturer of Hickory Clubs, Heritage Golf. Visitors are invited to watch the fascinating process for themselves.
What we do is take original clubs dating back as far as the 18th century, look at the materials used, and with our time-served craftsmen here in the factory, we're able to recreate clubs that perform just as those originals did.
Finally, you can't leave without visiting the St Andrews Ladies Putting Club. It's known as the Himalayas, and it's the best mini-golf you might ever play. Sometimes the ladies keep the course to themselves for competition, but more often than not, it's open to the public. And you can enjoy a putting challenge in an incomparable setting. As much as you've seen, believe it or not, we've only scratched the surface. The home of golf beckons. Come yourself and get to know and love the old grey toon of St Andrews. Across the Firth of Tay from St Andrews is the championship course that many regard as the most difficult in Scotland, Carnoustie. It has been described as a monster, especially when the wind blows and the rough is up, That's Sergio Garcia. He found that out in the 1999 Open. Right from your very first tee shot, it's game on. It takes nothing less than your best golf to make a birdie here. The course is sometimes called Car Nasty, though this may be in reference to the cold wind and rain that sweeps in across the North Sea. Tommy Armour, Henry Cotton, Gary Player, Tom Watson have all won Opens here, but for most people, Carnoustie is synonymous with Ben Hogan. He only entered the championship once, but his intense preparation was so legendary that it was no surprise that the wee Icemorn won the title in 1953. On the sixth hole, he threaded his drive so accurately on all 4 days between the out of bounds on the left and the first bunker that today the hole is aptly named Hogan's Alley. The 10th hole at Carnoustie is infamous too, but not because it was touched by golfing greatness. It's called South America, and this is how it got its name. One night, a local lad who had had one too many proclaimed that he was embarking on a great adventure to South America, but he didn't get far. When he woke up the next day, he'd only made it as far as the 10th green. Well, the 10th might not take you to South America, but it will take you to the Tea Hut, arguably Scotland's greatest halfway house. It said a stop here is optional, but believe me, it's mandatory. At the Tea Hut, you'll always be welcomed with a friendly smile as you enjoy much-needed refreshment. And you're invited to leave your bag tag on the wall for a little slice of immortality. Refreshed after your visit, you're ready for an even greater golfing challenge over the last 8 holes. Soon, you'll come to the 14th and the famous Spectacles bunkers. Even 20/20 vision won't help you see the green here. Club selection, indeed, is critical. On the other side, 150-foot putts await those unfortunate souls who've chosen incorrectly. The 17th is even scarier. The Barry Burn forms a veritable island fairway with all its twists and turns. Get past the burn and the treachery continues with numerous greenside bunkers. And finally, there's the story of Jean van der Velde and his adventures on the 18th in the 1999 Open. Needing only a double bogey to win, he fatefully pulled out his driver, attacked the hole, and the rest is history. He lost. You'll do well, though, to avoid Jean's fate in the Barry Burn. There's simply no room for error. There is more than one course at Carnoustie. In addition to the championship course, there's the Burnside, which was also used in the 1953 Open when everyone had to pre-qualify. It's another challenging layout and well named, for the Barry Burn plays an integral role in its design. Carnoustie has a third course too, the Budden Links, which is the closest of the three to the sea. Together, the courses make Carnoustie a world-class golfing destination, so give yourself plenty of time to enjoy it. The Carnoustie Golf Course Hotel was built for the 1999 Open and is one of Scotland's finest. Home of the world's largest Rolex, it's an integral part of the experience here, a la Turnberry. Many of the excellent rooms offer views of the course, and suites are named after Carnoustie's Open champions. The centerpiece being, not surprisingly, the Hogan Suite, available for private group dining. Downstairs is a world-class spa with massage treatments and a superb indoor pool facility. The dining is excellent, and the bar perfect for Carnoustie. You're guaranteed to be well looked after when you stay at the Carnoustie Golf Course Hotel. Across the street from the hotel are two local golf clubs, the Caledonia Golf Club with its distinctive clubhouse, and the Carnoustie Golf Club, established way back in 1842. If you play at Carnoustie, you're welcome to visit the clubs for the day, and it's a great way to meet the locals and hear stories of how so many golfers from Carnoustie a century ago helped to popularize the game in America. Ben Hogan fans have yet another reason to extend their stay at Carnoustie, because just a few miles away is the Panmure Golf Club at Barry. Besides Carnoustie, Panmure is the only other course in Scotland that Hogan ever played. He practiced at Panmure in the days leading up to the 1953 Open, and he learned the vagaries of Lynx golf there. He left an indelible mark, especially on the sixth. The hole is easy enough from the tee because there's a very generous landing area, but it turns scary on the second shot, played uphill into undulating dunes. There's trouble everywhere. It was Hogan's suggestion to place this bunker here, the only improvement he felt that the course needed. Once you've completed this gem of a hole, you will realize you've played one of Scotland's best. The Panmure Club is a classic gentleman's club with an appropriate clubhouse. It's old world, the way all golf clubhouses used to be. Remember, jacket and tie required in the members' lounge, which comes complete, incidentally, with its own snug, perfect for enjoying a quiet drink. What a treat to spend an evening in the traditional dining room and be able to fully absorb all of Panmure's own wonderful history. History of a different sort can be seen at nearby Glam's Castle. This was the childhood home of Her Majesty the Queen Mother and birthplace of Her Royal Highness Princess Margaret. Shakespeare even lives here in spirit because Glam's Castle is the setting of his play Macbeth. Yes, Carnoustie demands more than a day trip from St Andrews. With the three Carnoustie links, the Great Hotel and nearby Panmure and Glam's Castle, it calls for an extended stay to do it right. And do it right you should. The Kingdom of Fife is more than just St Andrews. Its famous fields of golds beckon, and numerous golfing gems too. Head towards Crail on the A917 coast road to King's Barnes. It's home to some ancient golfing ground and a modern links classic. King's Barnes was designed by Kyle Phillips and opened for the new millennium. Embracing the sea is the course's motto, very appropriate for the nearly unmatched setting. Golf at King's Barnes dates back to 1793, although the original layout was abandoned in the early 1900s. Today, the links has been resurrected to much acclaim. During course construction, an underground stream called a conduit and an ancient bridge were unearthed by the 18th Green. This little condy, as the locals call it, became an essential feature of the new King's Barnes links. On the 18th, it punishes any shot that comes up short. On the 6th, it devilishly hides behind the green, waiting to strike. You'll be cursing the bulldozers that unearth it when it comes time to retrieve your ball. The stream heads right for the North Sea, the essential feature of King's Barnes. Every single hole on the course is within sight of it. The third hole runs right along the shore, one of three incredible par fives by the beach. It's hard to imagine a more natural setting than the par five 12th, which takes golfers nearly all the way to Crail. Not to be outdone are the par threes. The second takes you right out to the water. And bring out the cameras on the signature 15th, a bit reminiscent of Cypress Point. It's all carry over the rocks, and it's all beauty as you walk to the green. The view back is just as good, especially if you've managed to hole a birdie putt. Does it look tough? Too tough? Well, you can always just take a walk along the seaside holes on the Fife coastal route, but you don't want to miss playing. No matter what your handicap, make sure you include King's Barnes on any St Andrews itinerary. At Crail on the east nuke of Fife, a little castle called Balcombe stands watch over one of golf's great pleasures. This is the Balcombe Links of the Crail Golfing Society, the world's seventh oldest club. Balcombe is a little treasure, ideal for a round of golf among friends. It's like playing on the Monterey Peninsula with the sea never out of sight. This really is old-fashioned golf. Not often can you putt from tee to green. And it has a real holiday spirit too. Any golfer would enjoy a drivable par four over a corner of the ocean. Crail is always busy with locals and visitors alike. They are drawn by the beauty, the charm, and the joy so unique to the Balcombe Links.
Crail, this is the seventh oldest golf club in the world. We were formed in 1786 and we've been on this particular course over 125 years. People like this because it's a very traditional links course.
The highlight of Balcombe is the 14th. The tee is perched high above the ocean near the clubhouse, the green far below the tee level, making club selection tricky. With Crail's trademark boathouse behind, this par 3 is one of the most attractive in Scotland. From 14, it's off to the other side of the clubhouse and numbers 15 through 18. What a delight they are, such as the 16th hole, a par 3, up the stairs. The view of the final four is unrivaled. It can be taken in over dinner in the old clubhouse, which befits a club as classic in legacy as the Crail Golfing Society. They do have a second 18 here, the Craig Head Links, which is a combination of Seaside Fife and perhaps a little bit of Kansas. What a combination the two courses make. Do yourself a favor, schedule a round or two at Crail while visiting the home of golf. On the south coast of Fife is another classic, the Golf House Club at Ely. Here you find golf's only submarine periscope, Excalibur. It's used by the starter to see over the mound in front of the first tee. Once you get the all clear, you're in for a real treat. Ely is another of the most enjoyable links courses in Scotland, with holes as scenic and as fun as any you'll ever play. You may not finish, though, if you venture into this little tavern off the fourth fairway. It's quite easy to drop your clubs, go across the street, and stay a while. In the centre of Fife, near the Scottish Deer Centre, is a course you'll want to roam, Lady Bank, the kingdom's premier inland course. Lady Bank is heathland in nature, making play nice and bouncy, like a seaside links. What a place to take a walk through the pines with a perfect Scottish cathedral standing watch. A break from the seaside winds, Lady Bank is one of the few inland open qualifying venues. It also stood in for the old course for a famous match in 1984 between Jack Nicklaus and Seve Ballesteros. Lady Bank is relaxed and welcoming to all. After a drink at the clubhouse bar, cap a perfect 5 day with dinner at the Peat Inn. Its ambience and the superb Scottish cuisine are a recipe for a memorable evening. You can even stay here in one of the 8 two-level suites just 10 minutes from St Andrews. The Kingdom of Fife, more than just St Andrews, its other courses capture the essence of Scottish golf. So don't forget to schedule some of those on your visit. The town of Gullen, or Gillen as some people say, in East Lothian revolves round golf. The main attraction is understandably Gullen Golf Club, a Scottish classic offering the chance to climb the Mount Everest of golf, Gullen Hill. We call it that not because of its size, which is manageable, but because surely no other hill is so glorious for golfers. Like St Andrews with its old, new, Jubilee and Eden courses, Gullen has its number one, number two and number three, all laid out around this beautiful hill. Here find the spirit of St Andrews, that special local flavour, but with fewer tourists. The most famous course is number one. What a setting as you play up and down and round Gullen Hill. On one side you look down towards the town, on the other towards the great Firth of Forth. It's so beautiful you don't need to be a golfer to enjoy it, but golfers certainly do. And the condition of the course is just as outstanding as the incredible setting. A highlight is perhaps the 17th, with its tee almost straight above the town. Tee shots soar high above, and the walk is downhill all the way. Running parallel to the 17th and Gullen number one is the 17th and Gullen number two. It's also straight downhill, the type of tee shot that everyone enjoys. Together, they make a pair of 17th holes to remember, bringing golfers back to town again, where more enjoyment awaits. Visitors have their own separate clubhouse at Gullen, nice and casual and perfect for a pint. Of course, you might want to head straight to the old clubhouse, maybe the best pub in town. It's actually the original Gullen clubhouse. The Golf Inn is a great little spot too, with rooms as well to satisfy any golfer. Or stay at the Mallard and wake up to this view of Gullen's great courses each morning. If you're looking for something really special, there's Grey Walls, designed in 1901 by the celebrated architect Sir Edwin Lutyens. Grey Walls is one of the finest country house hotels in Britain. Guests are treated, well, not so much as hotel guests, but as house guests in the Weaver home. Grey Walls has been in the Weaver family for most of its history. The rooms are a classic, quintessential Scottish experience, decorated in traditional style, and the gardens, tended to meticulously each day, are very beautiful. In the evenings, maybe a Louis XIII if you're feeling a bit extravagant. After all, it is the world's most expensive drink, but it's certainly the venue to enjoy it.
It was taken over by the military during the Second World War, and we got it back, or my parents got it back in 1947, and decided to start it as a hotel at that stage, but keep it as much like a family house as it's possible to do.
Although Grey Walls is not affiliated with the club, it occupies an ideal site overlooking the 10th tee at the famous Muirfield course. The championship test is seen here from the 7th tee at Gullen. It may be as close as many will ever get, because Muirfield can be a mysterious place, home of the Honourable Company of Edinburgh Golfers, the club which drew up the original 13 rules of golf all those years ago. It's one of the oldest clubs in the world, and it is very private. Stories abound of would-be visitors being denied the chance to play, but much of it is folklore. One incident did happen, though, following the conclusion of the 1980 Open Championship. Tom Watson, who just won the Claret Jug, and Ben Crenshaw decided to have a two-hole challenge match on the 10th and 18th holes using hickory clubs. Followed by an elite gallery, it was an epic battle in buttoned-up jackets. Down in the village, however, the then club secretary, Captain Paddy Hanmer, heard about the match and stormed out to the 18th green. He took the names of all involved and threatened to banish them from Muirfield forever. That's the story. In truth, Captain Hanmer ended up inviting Watson and Crenshaw to stay as his house guests on their next visit. You too can come to play around at Muirfield and experience its brilliant circular design, which was the first of its kind for a links course. This is provided you adhere to the notes for the guidance of visitors playing at Muirfield. If you do, it's unlikely you would ever be blackballed, although the same couldn't be said for prospective members in the old days. Using this special contraption, members anonymously voted yea or nay on a particular prospect, a blackball requiring 20 yes votes to offset it. Every Open champion at Muirfield since 1959 has stayed at neighbouring Grey Walls, including Tom Watson in 1980, Nick Faldo in 1992, and Ernie Els in 2002, when a particularly boisterous celebration was held in the hotel bar. You might say there is a trend here.
We've had a very good run. Gary Player in 1959, Jack Nicklaus in 1966, Lee Trevino. He made a famous speech about needing his cheque to come and pay our bill, which was quite wrong, because but anyway, in 1972, I think that was.
Muirfield has no professional shop, but merchandise with the official Muirfield logo can still be bought. Where? Well, at Hume Golf and Leisure in the centre of Gullen. Owned by golf professional Jimmy Hume, this is the place to buy sought-after Muirfield souvenirs, because Jimmy has the exclusive rights from the club. Just past the turn to Muirfield on the way to North Berwick is the sleepy town of Durdleton, and in it you'll find the beautiful old Durdleton Castle, located in the midst of some beautiful gardens and dating back to the 13th century. Just across from the castle is an ideal place for lunch and a pint, the Castle Inn. This traditional Tudor building is also a little hotel, perfect for those wanting an uncommercial, inexpensive accommodation choice. A few minutes past Durdleton is another golfing gem, a west course at North Berwick. With a start and a finish right in the heart of the town, the first and 18th holes immediately bring to mind St Andrews. Hard by the sea, with the famous Bass Rock a few miles offshore, North Berwick is a lynx of impeccable charm and character, home to the North Berwick Golf Club. It's the kind of course you come to Scotland to play, requiring you to produce those little bump-and-run shots that are so important on the links. Holes such as the second at the Sea Hole put North Berwick on any list of Scotland's most elite. The 13th might put a pit in your stomach, but that's not why it's called the pit. The pit refers to the sunken green behind an ancient stone wall, unusual to say the least. The approach shot must come directly over the wall. The further left in the fairway, the better the angle of approach. Miss right, and you'll need the perfect pitch to carry the wall and hold the green. The only way, of course, to get to the green might require you to thread one through the opening in the wall. What a shot this is. Only in Scotland, I hear you say. The most copied hole in golf is also right here at North Berwick, the 15th, Redan. Now, redan is a military term meaning formation. Bunkers protect the front, and the green slopes front to back and is tilted left. North Berwick winds down with a green that must be seen to be believed, the 16th. Two huge plateaus are separated by a near 6 foot deep swale. The putt rolls, then disappears, then hopefully appears again. Few designers would get away with this type of green today. The West Course provides an encyclopedia of the intricacies of links golf. Each hole is its own volume, existing until now only in your wildest dreams. When you make the journey to North Berwick, stay right on top of the course at the Marine Hotel. Its classic Scottish architecture is a perfect match for the historic links it overlooks. On the other side of Gullen Hill, there's a course few play but many are mystified by, Loughness New Golf Club. The course is sandwiched between Gullen and neighbouring Aberlady, and seen by everyone driving into golf at Gullen, Muirfield or North Berwick. Loughness New opened in 1894 when a group of members broke from Loughness Old Club. They took their original nine and commissioned old Tom Morris to design nine more. Today, the club with its inviting clubhouse is very enticing and obviously at ease with itself. To many, it's a miniature Muirfield, a classic club that is very private. But visitors are welcomed, and what a delight it is to play. Famous for its rolling terrain and true greens, it's a regular open qualifying venue when the championship comes to Muirfield. The only thing separating Loughness New from the more famous courses in the area is a few hundred yards on the scorecard. However, there seems little interest among members in finding that additional length. And they certainly don't need to find a better setting either. Historic castle ruins are in view on the front side, potentially quite distracting here on the second hole. On the back nine, the great Firth of Forth dominates the scenery. Ships pass down from Leith, and the links of Gullen Golf Club along neighbouring Gullen Hill border the entire course. The finish at Loughness New is particularly noteworthy. Heading directly towards the clubhouse, the 17th offers terrific bunkering and lots of undulation. 18 keeps you heading straight for home, and when you've putted out on the final green, it's just a quick walk across the A198 road to the 19th hole. No starting times are given here, just permission to come and play when the tee is clear. Loughness New is a hidden links favourite. But what, I hear you say, happened to the Loughness Old Club? Well, the remaining members moved down the coast and opened Kilspindie Golf Club in 1898. Now, Kilspindie is fun. It's a linksy course that's not of championship length, but it's a great place for an afternoon round. Another big draw is the 19th hole at Kilspindie, which serves as bar, clubroom and locker room all in one. What a place to spend some time. It makes Kilspindie worth checking out. Closer to Edinburgh is a chance to step back in time at Musselburgh Links. This nine-holer sits within the confines of the old racetrack and remains just as it was when it held 6 open championships in the late 1800s. What an experience it is to duck under the rails here. You play the same layout as Musselburgh's Open champions did all those years ago, and can even try out hickory clubs. You'll also get to meet Mrs. Foreman's. That's the par 4 fourth hole, arguably the most challenging on the links. The toughest part is keeping your focus on the game, because right behind the green is an historic pub, Mrs. Foreman's, which gives the hole its name. Refreshments used to be available through an old window, giving new meaning to drive-through service. But today you have to come inside for a pint, but that's not any problem. Finally, no visit to the Edinburgh area is complete without seeing the old city itself. Edinburgh Castle, what a magnificent sight. Historic, right at the top of the Royal Mile, the road that runs down from the castle to the Queen's residence at Holyrood House. And with historic pubs to explore like the Jekyll and Hyde, a spirited visit is more than guaranteed. Yes, the Edinburgh East Lothian region is ideal for the astute golfer. It's challenging, it's historic, it's incomparable. These courses are all links to the past. A visit here is one to treasure. Welcome to Gleneagles, the famous Palace of the Glens, and Scotland's preeminent inland course, the King's. Designed by the illustrious James Braid here in the foot of the Scottish Highlands, there's no finer setting for a game of golf. The pheasants know a great course when they see it, and the King's has that great look to it, one that says, this is not your ordinary inland course. The terrain separates the King's from the rest, with raised greens and constant elevation changes. The deceptively deep bunkering is to be avoided at all costs. One particularly tough bunker, called Old Nick, protects the left of the 13th, named Braid's Prowest. Braid always signed his name to the hole he considered the best on his courses. On the King's, he chose this one. There's even the occasional blind shot to navigate on the King's course, like the approach to the par 4 third. This is a classic Scottish golf hole, early in the round, a suitable introduction to the Gleneagles spirit. The bell has been rung. The King's course is a masterpiece. It's a course all golfers would enjoy, a must for any golf tour to Scotland. James Braid designed a second gem here at Gleneagles, the Queen's course. Its setting is more wooded and secluded than the King's. Though not as long and playing to a par of 68, the Queen's is nonetheless special. The finish is as good as any in Scotland, starting with the par 3 17th. Steep bunkers and a deep ravine guard the right side. The lengthy green is a good 100 feet from front to back and deceivingly narrow. This is a beautiful and difficult par 3. But the most scenic hole at Gleneagles may be the next one. This is the 18th on the Queen's, par 4, downhill, all the way, and what a vista. The 18th is a magnificent finish, and the Queen's course is a perfect complement to the King's. But you know, there's still more golf at Gleneagles. Gleneagles is one of the few Ryder Cup venues in Europe, and the PGA Centenary course will host the event in, well, wait for it, 2014. In this traditional Scottish setting, Jack Nicklaus has crafted a modern classic worthy of such a great event. What a stage for golf's greatest players. And like the King's and Queen's courses, you can play the PGA Centenary while at Gleneagles. Trademark Nicklaus design features are found throughout the course. Some bunkers are so deep, the pin can barely be seen. One of the highlights is the ninth, a long par 5 of almost 570 yards. Big hitters can go for the green in two, but water and a huge bunker stand in the way. The view from behind the green is the defining shot of the PGA Centenary course. If you come to Gleneagles, you simply can't miss it. You would want to stay at the Gleneagles Hotel even without the golf. It's one of the world's finest. The rooms are grand and offer wonderful views of the estate and the surrounding countryside. You could stay here forever, but settle at least for a couple of nights, because the Gleneagles experience is unforgettable. Many visitors to Aberdeen come to follow the stunning Castle Trail. Included on the trail, Castle Fraser, built in 1719, and Craigie Var Castle, which has changed little since its creation, in 1626. But it's the ruins of Slane's Castle that draws golfers, because they mark the location of perhaps Scotland's most ethereal course, Cruden Bay. The great writer Bram Stoker spent many summers among those ruins when on holiday at Cruden Bay, and they were the inspiration for his novel, Dracula. I saw the whole man emerge from the window and begin to crawl down the castle wall over the dreadful abyss, wrote Stoker, his cloak spreading around him like great wings. What a spirited backdrop Slane's Castle casts for this Scottish venue. The golf course was originally the course of the old Cruden Bay Hotel, but its baronial structure was sadly razed in 1953. But the course remains, hallowed links land with evidence of the game being played here as far back as 1791. It's a shame the old hotel no longer stands to complement the old Dracula ruins, but not everything is lost. The original professional shop seen in this photo still stands today at the bottom of the hill. The routing of the course also remains largely unchanged since old Tom Morris laid it out in 1899. For instance, the backdrop of the fourth hole, Port Errol, remains the same as it ever was. Cruden Bay is often called the Ballybunion of Scotland because of the mammoth dunes. The course has many memorable holes, but especially this one, the eighth, a short par four, just begging for an overswing. Once you've holed out on the eighth green, golfers walk up a path to the highest point on the course, which provides you with one of Scotland's grandest views, back towards the haunting ruins of Slane's Castle. Amazingly, the view is nearly matched on the 10th tee. This beach looks as if it belongs in the tropics, doesn't it? The sand is even a little pink, but beware. The water of the North Sea is always ice cold. With blind shots and greens in tiny hollows, Cruden Bay is an extraordinary links. To ensure you don't play until the green is clear here, they have the longest bell in Scotland, rung by a pulley from the 16th tee, signalling that the green on 15 is clear. The tee shot from 16 is then hit directly over it. Waiting behind the green are deep depressions, fittingly called the coffins. Stay out of them, or you'll likely be dead. Cruden Bay might just be the Scottish course which captures your imagination. It certainly caught Bram Stoker's. Just 10 minutes away is the town of Newborough and an appealing hotel, the Udney Arms. This is a classic Scottish accommodation with lots of nooks and crannies. The Udney Arms Hotel is also renowned for its cuisine, and the hotel bar is quite a useful spot for you to enjoy your evening. Near the heart of Aberdeen is a classic old Scottish golf club, Royal Aberdeen. Here you can putt in the shadows of one of Scotland's most venerable clubhouses, perfect for a club that dates back to 1780. You can also play the club's Balgownie Links, a difficult layout that some say could easily host an Open Championship. The front nine is especially severe, with fairways between huge dunes, a visually stunning and dramatic series of holes. The third epitomizes the challenge, a long par three with the tee high in the sandhills. The green is down in the valley, hidden away from the breezes, demanding precision if you're going to hit it. The back nine is no slouch either, as this bunkering will attest. The 17th is particularly spectacular, played straight out to the North Sea. It's a fine culmination to this glorious links, but not the end of the attraction at Royal Aberdeen. Seen here in this 1920s photograph, the clubhouse is, well, worthy of its own green fee. Inside, the formal lounge is well suited to a club with such a distinguished history. Jackets are always politely required to be worn. The lounge is graced by a portrait of Her Majesty the Queen, and also includes the captain's chair, dating back to the founding of Royal Aberdeen in 1780. There is a reminder of all the club captains next door in the more casual old bar. Historic photos of them are grouped by the decades, going back to practically the invention of the camera. With a great view down the first hole and out to see the old bar is a 19th hole to enjoy. Aberdeen is Scotland's third largest city, which means it has no shortage of attractions or great places to stay. The best may be the Marcliffe at Pitfoddles. It's a country hotel close to the city. Each bedroom is individually designed with comfort as a primary objective. Some of the suites are so well done they've been named. Suites come with a bedroom, a sitting room, and grand bathrooms to match. And the public rooms are equally grand and very inviting. And speaking of the public areas, be sure to visit the billiard room, perfect for a late night game of snooker. But the ultimate public room is where you'll discover award-winning cuisine, perhaps the country's best seafood bisque, and the choicest of surf and turf entrees. One of Scotland's biggest surprises is just 15 miles south of Aberdeen. No, this isn't Pebble Beach in Scotland, although there is a resemblance. This is Stonehaven Golf Club, a beautiful, casual club whose executive length course occupies a setting quite beyond belief, At Stonehaven, you play on clifftops high above the sea. Views just carry on forever. But make no mistake, this is not a championship golf course. The course is barely 5,000 yards and has no less than 7 par threes. But you don't come to Stonehaven for a championship test, just an enjoyable round with the locals. You also come to boost your ego. Par is just 64 from the yellow markers. And we won't tell anyone if you shoot in the 70s. But don't get ahead of yourself. Stonehaven is still challenging. The 15th, called Gully Cup, is as good a one-shotter as any in Scotland. The tee shot must be well struck to have any chance of getting across the gully. It's launched from the site of the original Stonehaven clubhouse, where today only a chimney remains. If you come up short, the long walk around the gully to the green allows plenty of time to ponder your next shot. It won't be easy, but you wouldn't be the first to succumb to this difficult hole. Stonehaven's 15th is one of the best par threes you'll play in Scotland. It's a fitting end to our tour of the Aberdeen area. With a large cosmopolitan base and beautiful accessible golf courses intermingled with incredible Scottish history, our advice to you is simply this: definitely give it a go. High on the coast of the Murray Firth, where the winds can really whip up at times, is a golf course that was one of the original hidden gems of Scotland, Nairn Golf Club. In the old days, few overseas visitors ever came here. But now that it's been discovered and the word is spread quickly, Nairn is firmly established on any list of must-play courses. Nairn is home to what I suppose might be the world's longest water hazard. The first 7 holes hug the coast of the Murray Firth. But remember, if you do hit one on the beach, play it. You're not out of bounds. Nairn is probably best known for its course conditioning. Many consider it to have the finest set of greens in the country. These gently sloping, very true surfaces are always slick and challenging. Even 80 years ago, the great James Braid commented, "The texture of the turf and character of the greens is unrivaled." Starter Jack Forsyth talks to many of the golfers playing then, and can certainly back up Braid's shrewd comment.
Play well, gentlemen.
I would say it's the number one in Scotland, especially the greens. I've had a few comments today from American tourists that have seen nothing better, played nothing better. And they've played Troon, Turnberry, Muirfield, St Andrews this week, and this is the best.
2 par threes also highlight the quality of the course. On the front side, there's the short fourth, a little diamond heading straight for the Murray Firth. It may only be a short iron, but it's not to be overlooked because the small green is a tough target and always difficult to negotiate. The highlight on the back nine is the 14th. It's a much longer and tougher par three, one that is, well, quite simply spectacular. It's Nairn's signature hole. Nairn now has a firm place in British Championship golf. It's hosted the Amateur Championship and, even more famously, the 1999 Walker Cup.
We've held several major amateur competitions here, the most important one being the Walker Cup, where Great Britain and Ireland
triumphed over the USA.
That's right.
Nairn is great golf, classically Scottish. And the setting is just as superb. What a place it is to come and spend a few days. Just up the drive from the clubhouse is the Golf View Hotel, ideally located close to the links. This 4-star hotel has some of the best rooms in the Highlands, with an outstanding conservatory restaurant looking out to the sea. And there's, as always, an atmospheric bar. There's a leisure club too that offers the ultimate in relaxation. Great for the golfers, but a superb base too for the non-golfers in your group. Just across the street is the Golf View's sister hotel, the Newton, built in 1872 as a family home. Today it provides the comfort of a bygone era, a home away from home. The Newton has 56 wonderfully appointed bedrooms, many in the original building. and all of them have their own special features. Just 30 minutes from Nairn, golfers can tackle one of golf's most unusual hazards, aircraft noise from fighter jets. The old course at Murray Golf Club borders the adjacent RAF base in the town of Lossiemouth. This golfing venue is unique in that it comes complete with runway lights in the middle of the course. It also offers the rare opportunity to get up close and personal with these amazing flying machines. Depending on the wind, they either take off or land right over the heads of those playing. You can practically reach up and touch them. But Old Murray is not just for golfers with a passion for aircraft. It's a real golfing treat, reminiscent of that other old course down in St. Andrews. Looking back from the course towards the clubhouse and distant spires of Lossiemouth, the similarity, in fact, is striking. The layout starts and finishes in the heart of the town, just as the old course does at St. Andrews. And the classic stone clubhouse reminds us of the one at the home of golf. Yet Old Murray would be worth the visit even without the comparison. Designed by no less a figure than old Tom Morris, Murray Old is the most traditional of links layouts, with lots of subtle undulations demanding that you play plenty of those precise little bump and run shots so typical of Scottish golf. You also get a taste of Turnberry here as well, because at the far end of the course is a beautiful lighthouse down by the beach on the shores of the Firth. Visitors are always welcome, and what an opportunity it is to experience one of Scotland's most traditional clubs.
It's a traditional Scottish links course and club designed by old Tom Morris in 1889. That's when the club was first formed. Traditional, 9 holes out of the town, turn round back into the town and finish in the town, very similar to St. Andrews. So we're very proud of the tradition that we've got here at Lossiemouth.
A visit to Murray Golf Club in Lossiemouth is a must for those spending a few nights in Nairn. And incidentally, don't be afraid of those jets. If you're easily startled, just visit on a Sunday when the RAF takes a day off. No trip to the Highlands is complete without sampling one of the most beautiful golf courses you'll ever see, Boat of Garten. This is a hidden delight tucked away in the Scottish Alps, the Cairngorm Mountains. Boat of Garten has turf that rivals any seaside links. In fact, it looks and plays like a links course in the sky. The fairways ripple their way through the hills, lined with heather, gorse and trees. Boat of Garten may be shorter than most courses, but it more than makes up for that in its beauty and the challenge it provides. The 15th is quite unusual. It's named Gully, and it has not one, but potentially 2 blind shots, each marked by a directional pole. Long hitters try to carry the gully to get near to the green, but do so at the pedal. Others play into the gully and then wedge up blindly to the green. You can also lay up short of the gully for a longer shot and a clearer view of the putting surface. I guess you could say the 15th is a very democratic hole with many choices. Choose carefully though, find the rough and you'll be severely punished. One of the course's most demanding shots is the drive on 12, sharply downhill to a mere sliver of a fairway. You know, it's easy to see why the locals love this place. You really could never tire of this kind of golf. Boat of Garten is happily still a virtual secret. Not many overseas tourists find their way to it. What a perfect complement it is to a tour of the great seaside links. The place to stay overlooks the course, the Boat Hotel. Distinctive and unforgettable are apt words to describe this 4-star accommodation. The hotel is passionate about its cuisine, and a memorable dining experience is assured. To stay at the Boat Hotel is to do something special on your tour and is highly recommended. Also recommended is the exclusive Royal Scotsman train, which offers golf and sightseeing tours of the Highlands with accommodation on board. The Royal Scotsman often berths overnight at the adjacent Strathspey railway station. And you know, it's a majestic way to see the countryside. The golf courses of Nairn, Murray Old and Boat of Garten form a near triangle, if you like, around the famous Speyside Whiskey Trail. Home of more than half of Scotland's distilleries, no visit here is complete without a tour and, of course, a taste of the local product, like the Macallan, one of the world's finest. The Macallan Distillery and Visitor Centre is located between Murray Golf Club and Boat of Garten. Here you discover Easter Elkie's house, spiritual home of the whisky. For 300 years, it stood by the River Spey, and it's the same house that is depicted on the Macallan's packaging. The visitor centre is open 365 days a year and offers the chance to buy and sample all the best whiskies in the world. Behind the scenes is a man with an enviable job, Bob Delgano, whisky maker at the Macallan. Believe it or not, he's the man who samples everything from the 10-year-old to the rarest of the rare. What a wonderful region of Scotland this is, with distinctive old distilleries, outstanding accommodation, and excellent golfing choices, which are not overly busy. Make sure that this slice of Scotland makes it onto your itinerary. The Scottish Highlands, renowned internationally for some of the world's most breathtaking scenery. This is the home of Loch Ness and famous Urquhart Castle, a magnet for tourists. There's still no tangible sign of the monster, old Nessie, but, well, that's another story. The signs clearly point to a place of golfing legend, Roald Donoch. A visit here is the culmination of a lifelong dream for many. Roald Donoch has that certain look to it, one shared by only the most elite of courses. Right from the start, a short testing opener, you know you're experiencing something extraordinary. The splendor of Donoch is fully revealed when you arrive at the third tee. It's a spine-tingling moment as the entire course opens up before your eyes. It hits you there and then that you're actually here, at one of Scotland's most fabled venues. Donald Ross learned his craft at Donoch. The upside-down saucer greens here became his trademark, just as they are at Pinehurst No. 2. They can be nearly impossible to hit. Some say the most difficult shot at Roald Donoch is the second to the second, a brutal par 3. The third shot may be even worse. In fact, each of the course's par 3s is special. The sixth requires a nearly perfect shot. Miss left, and you're in the gorse. Miss right, and you're so far down, you better have a Phil Mickelson-type flop shot in your arsenal. Even if you do, a slick putt awaits and a likely bogey. More trouble lurks at the 10th, the shortest of the par threes, but often the toughest to hit. If you do miss the green, the chip is incredibly difficult. Yes, Roald Donoch punishes errant shots, but it makes up for it with the most wonderful views. Let the mind stray. Lose concentration for a second, and I tell you, you'll be severely punished. The gorse is practically everywhere. The hillsides are full of the stuff. There's just something about the plant that tenses up the muscles, steering the ball into thorny oblivion. Yet each hole at Donoch is a masterpiece. At the far end of the course is the eighth. After a blind drive over a hill, you're left with a tricky approach. It must be judged perfectly. Similar to the 8th is the 17th, which calls for an accurate tee shot to the crest of a hill. Any ball trickling to the edge rolls all the way down. Perfect position for the approach. The green is protected by thick whins and guarded by even more bunkers. What a golf hole! And not even the best at Roald Donoch, the pièce de résistance is the 14th, aptly named Foxy. It's a cunning hole in that it doesn't have a single bunker to navigate. It looks gentle enough, but if your drive isn't placed properly, it affects the view for your approach. This is important as the target is one of the best raised greens on earth. Even a slightly mishit chip shot is quickly repelled away. Foxy is the most natural hole on one of the world's most natural courses. It's also one of the most historic. And speaking of history, take the time to visit the Roald Donoch Clubhouse. Inside is one of the most revered of golf trophies, the incomparable Carnegie Shield. Played for annually since 1901, it was presented to the club by Andrew Carnegie. Mr. Carnegie can be seen here in the background following the 1905 competition. Nearly every golfer in Scotland wants his name on this plaque, as do many from overseas. The trophy always stays in the clubhouse, but to have one's name engraved upon it is to gain a small piece of immortality. Royal Donegal has a second course, the Strewy, a wonderful venue for a delightful evening round. The Strewy heads all the way to the Donegal Firth. In fact, the Firth is very much in play. The greens on the Strewy are also quite challenging. This gentleman possesses a magical touch. The Strewy incorporates holes that were originally part of the championship course, and this is evident on the short second, where, if you do miss the green, that will demand you play another of those flop shot recoveries, if you can. Next to the 18th tee is the greenkeeper's house. A certain marker in his garden is called the Witch's Stone. It marks the spot where Janet Horne, the last witch in Scotland, was burned at the stake in 1722. She was convicted on the evidence that two of her fingers were joined. The adjacent 18th is named after her, a par three over the Witch's Pool. Donegal is obviously a spirited place, quite rich in history. That spirit comes alive on Saturday nights when the Donegal Pipe Band marches. This weekly event brings out the locals in droves, and they never tire of this wonderful spectacle. Let's sit back and enjoy it for just a little bit. Donegal also boasts one of Scotland's oldest cathedrals, dating back to 1428. It gained international fame when pop singer Madonna had her child baptised here. On the right day, it's a symphony to behold. So where does one stay in Donegal? Well, one of the best values in Scotland is the Eagle Hotel right in town. They offer bank house accommodation above the bank across the street. Superb rooms that are classic in style and very spacious. The bar is popular with locals and visiting golfers in the evenings, and a delicious breakfast provides the energy needed for golf the following morning. Just down the road is Highfield House, the highest rated B&B in this part of Scotland. Back at the course, you could hardly stay closer to any first tee than at the Royal Golf Hotel, one of the finest in the Highlands. Here the rooms are par excellence, many with views of the course and Donegal Firth. The cosy Tom Morris Bar begs for a sampling of great Scottish whisky by the roaring fire, especially after a delicious meal in the hotel dining room. Well, how do you sum up the Donegal experience? Let's leave it to Tom Watson. He called Donegal the most fun he ever had playing golf. You can't say it any better than that. Across the Donegal Firth in the Royal Borough of Tain, one of the world's truly great whiskies is distilled. This is Glenmorangie Distillery. Not Glenmorangie, as so many like to say, but Glenmorangie. Cask after cask of this unique single malt has been produced here for centuries. What a place to take a tour, to indulge in this passion of the Scots. The warehouses store row upon row of maturing casks, each on a journey of at least 10 years. During that time, the aromas and flavors that make Glenmorangie so special are able to develop. Glenmorangie whiskies are handcrafted by the 16 men of Tain, whose skill and expertise bring it to life. But who exactly are these 16 men? Perhaps they're Scottish legend, not unlike Willy Wonka's mysterious helpers, hiding deep behind the stone walls.
The 16 men of Tain. Well, I don't know all their names personally, but we only have 16 men who work here. Just 16. It's famous, the 16 men of Tain, but there is only 16 men. We've got 4 in the mash house, 4 in the still house, and 8 warehouse men, and they just work on shifts.
Yes, not much has changed over the years. The Glenmorangie Distillery you see today is as it has been and as it always will be. Once your visit with the 16 men of Tain is complete, it's time to play the 18 holes of Tain Golf Club, designed by old Tom Morris in 1890. Tain is a hidden gem worthy of similar accolades. Like the great whiskies crafted nearby, every hole here has its own inimitable character. The most famous is the 11th, named the Alps, as unique and flavorful as any Scottish single malt. Heading straight for the Donegal Firth, the second shot must carry 2 giant mounds guarding the green. The approach is completely blind, the kind of shot that would never be incorporated in any golf course today. Remember, club selection is vital while in Scotland. As they like to say here, make sure you choose Tain. It's only natural that a perfect base for this region is Glenmorangie House in Cadboll. Owned by the distillery in a setting of magnificent beauty, it's an experience in its own right. Just imagine the evening spent tasting the finest Glenmorangie malts in this traditional Highland mansion. It is, in fact, as if you've entered someone's home. Dinners are served family style at the dining room table, where you actually get the chance to meet the other guests. Each of the spacious bedrooms is individually furnished with king-size beds and views out into the gardens. Like the distillery itself, Glenmorangie House is enveloped in tranquility. You must consider a stay here. There's another must-play course in the Highlands, Brora Golf Club, about 25 minutes from Dornoch. Don't be, well, shocked, shall we say, by the little electric fences surrounding the greens, because Brora is home to Scotland's most famous, say, greenkeepers or groundskeepers, the sheep that roam the course. The fences serve to keep them at bay and protect the putting surfaces, but make sure you step over the wire. Brora is links golf as it was meant to be. Five times Open champion Peter Thomson called it the purest links golf course in the world. And who would disagree? Unaltered since James Braid's redesign in 1923, Brora is a time capsule that captures the game as it was almost a century ago. Charm notwithstanding, the layout is superb. The challenge cannot be underestimated, such as on the ninth, the par 3 C hole. Much of the trouble is hidden from view and the sea is hard by at the edge of the green. The 16th, a tricky par 4, is aptly named Plateau. The second shot must avoid the deep gorge left of the green and an unseen bunker on the right. Brora is uniquely playable because of the livestock's constant tending to the rough. It never fails to delight, and it's a sight to behold. For pure enjoyment, Brora ranks right at the top of our list. A day here is an experience you'll never forget. Adjacent to the club is the four-star Royal Marine Hotel, built in 1911, and which still retains its original charm. The bedrooms are classic in style, and they've been fully modernized. The grand staircase contributes to the quiet elegance, and the overall ambience will make any golfer feel at home. You will especially enjoy the wood-paneled snooker room. Like golf, snooker is impossible to master, but more fun in the proper surroundings. What a tour we've had up near Dornoch. Let's cap it off with this view of nearby Dunrobin Castle. Like the rest of the Highlands, it's almost out of a fairy tale. This is the magic that awaits you. Off Scotland's west coast are some of the most ruggedly beautiful islands in the world, and they hold three gloriously remote golfing experiences. One is Macrahanish on the Mull of Kintyre. It's Scotland's mainland island. It's actually a peninsula, but it's just 3 hours from Glasgow. Macrahanish may be the last great, truly undiscovered championship course in Scotland. With the sea on one side and beautiful countryside on the other, this is a setting to match any other. At Macrahanish, there's simply no pretense. Even the ball retrievers are part of the welcome, complete with a smiler or just a wag. This is what you cross oceans to discover. Speaking of which, of all the world's great courses, only one calls for a drive over a corner of the Atlantic Ocean on your very first tee shot. It happens here at Macrahanish. Surely this is the most thrilling opening shot in golf. And power is definitely required if you want to take the most direct line to the green. If you hit a good tee shot, suddenly a birdie opportunity presents itself. Macrahanish is a traditional out and back links, full of appealing undulations. It's a beguiling track with tricky bunkers, and there's no escaping the uneven lie. The incoming tides can bring swift changes in wind direction, making club selection critical. Adjacent to the course is Campbellton Airport. On this high spot, members love to admire the beauty just out to sea. Chief among these is the Isle of Islay, a romantic place we will see a little bit later. Alas, the sun will eventually set on what is destined to be a round of golf to remember. But though the course may end right in the heart of this convivial Scottish village, the experience does not. Head to the Beachcomber Pub afterwards, the original clubhouse at Macrahanish Golf Club. Inside, gather with the locals and share stories about golf. You may even be lucky enough to get an impromptu music session.
Heads up, Canadian Rockies. Rippling waters wide.
Or perhaps not. Regardless, a good time is guaranteed at the Beachcomber. For those who stay late, spend the night at Ardell House, a short walk from both the pub and the club. This is a terrific B&B with ideal rooms for visiting golfers. You know, there's nothing like accommodation that looks over the golf course, and there's nothing quite like Macrahanish. You should get here before everyone else does. Up the Kintyre coast from Macrahanish is the port of Kennacraig, where you can board an impressive ferry and embark on a relaxing and scenic journey. You're on your way to the Scotland of your dreams, Islay. Breathtakingly natural, indescribably beautiful, and home of the Macrae Hotel and Golf Links, a place well worth the effort to get to. Here you'll find a golf course beyond the wildest of your dreams, a trip back in time. The Macrae was designed by Willie Campbell in 1891, and not much of this sandy terrain has changed since. Only the most astute of golfing historians know what awaits them before they play. Enticing golf, totally captivating, and perhaps even a bit maddening at first, for there are nearly too many blind shots to list. They start right on the first hole. The little direction poles mark the way. These appear throughout the round, little beacons of hope to help you, I suppose, keep your temper, which happens to be the motto of the local Islay Golf Club. X will even mark the spot on the seventh, a little bit of extra courtesy to first-timers. Just return the favour by sounding the bell when you've finished to announce the green is clear. The Macrae will send flowers your way should some of this be too much, but alas, this is in the form of a flower hazard, which is a stroke penalty on the par 3 tenth. You can always ask a local for guidance, but remember this is simply old-fashioned golf. The highlight is the 17th, a candidate for the favourite hidden links hole in Scotland. It's vintage Macrae, as it was in the very beginning, and thank goodness for that. If a course were designed here today, this wonderful hidden green location would have been bulldozed to make room for something far more mundane. Not everything is blind here, though. In fact, quite the contrary. Take the 15th, Willie's Fancy, the designer's favourite hole. You'll fancy it as much as old Willie Campbell did, especially if you're able to find the green on your approach. At the Macrae, the ghosts of Harry Vardon and James Braid and J.H. Taylor still walk the wooden stairs. The great triumvirate were participants in the Macrae Open of 1901, won by Taylor. This exciting event offered the then largest purse in history, £100.
So they decided that they were going to have the biggest prize ever offered for a golf tournament to try and attract the best golfers of the day who happened to be playing in the Open at Muirfield the previous week. They scheduled it for the week after the Open, and they attracted the great triumvirate, which was J.H. Taylor, Harry Vardon and James Braid. Also Sandy Hurd, Andrew Kirkcaldy, Ben Sayers, all the eminent golfers of the day.
The bottom line, play the Macrae twice. The second time around, you'll know where you're going. You will then fall in love with it, if you haven't already. That means an overnight stay, of course, at the Macrae Hotel. That's essential. The atmosphere only adds to the experience of Islay. Cuisine is a major part of the hotel, and the menu is full of Scottish flavour. Upstairs, the bedrooms are ideal for a good night's rest before heading out to the links again. Islay is not just about golf. Even more famous are the distilleries and their peaty delights. One of the finest is Ardbeg, perhaps the ultimate single Islay malt, and definitely the most peaty. What a pleasure it is to explore the old Ardbeg grounds. The atmosphere is as thick as the sugary liquid being extracted in the mash tuns. These giants are taking this liquid from the smoky barley, and it'll eventually become whiskey. Ardbeg is home to the oldest working mill in Scotland, dating back to 1881. You can also learn about the washbacks, the giant metal containers called stills, and the spirit receiver from which the future whiskey is put into casks and then sent on its journey through time. Visitors are always welcome at this friendliest of distilleries, where they experience the essence of Islay.
You just have to look around this island. I mean, every single Islay malt on Islay has a coastal location. Everyone a wee bit different. You've got the three big peaty monsters in the south of the island. You have the kind of gentler Bruichladdies, Bannahavans. You have the cove where Kalila sits. And they're all absolutely special in their own way. And each one of them has, everything a single malt whiskey could have.
You can visit nearly all the distilleries on Islay, such as Lagavulin, which isn't far down the road. And you don't have to take the ferry to get here. The airport next to the course has daily flights to and from Glasgow. Islay is distinctive and enthralling. No matter how you arrive, you may never want to leave. When you do, you won't see the likes of it until you return again. And believe me, you will be back. Ferries can also take you to the Isle of Arran. Here you'll discover our pick for the most unusual course in Scotland, Shiskin Golf Club in Blackwater Foot. There are only 12 holes here, seven of which are par threes, but these 12 are some of the most interesting you're ever likely to play. The course is six holes short, but hardly lacking in beauty. The terrain at Shiskin is as exciting as the golf itself. They do things their own way on the Isle of Arran. For example, instead of a bell, this pulley system shows that the seventh green is clear. The entertainment really begins on the par three third, aptly named Crow's Nest. The tee shot is blind and, well, nearly vertical. The green is set on an impossibly high shelf, obviously no easy target. From there, it's downhill from this same perch on the fourth, one of those shots where your tee shot seems to, well, hang forever in the air. You can spend the night close to the course at the neighboring Kinloch Hotel, based right on the shore's edge. And if you're not in a hurry on your tour, then do something few other golfers take time to experience. Go to the Isle of Arran and play 12 at Shiskin. About 45 minutes by road from Glasgow in the west of Scotland is a club with a history and tradition that rivals even St Andrews. Prestwick Golf Club, birthplace of the Open. Can you imagine the first Open Championship was played on this very ground in 1860? Yes, 1860. Abraham Lincoln had yet to be elected President of the United States. On the first tee, you stare out at the famous Railway Hole and realize you're in for something special. The fairway is hard against the stone railway wall. Anything over it is headed for Glasgow in the north or Stranraer to the south. It's a fascinating start to this journey through history with Prestwick Airport behind the green. Soon you reach the third, and with it a nightmare for the average golfer, the Cardinal Bunker. It must have been impossible to cross this menacing stretch of sand and railroad ties back in the days of hickory and gutta percha. Today, for most golfers, it still remains a problem. The Cardinal cuts across the fairway about 250 yards from the tee, making this short par five play much longer. The par three fifth is no kinder. It's called the Himalayas, and the tee shot is completely blind. And only the slightest of clues is given to the actual location of the pin. Crossing the Himalayas allows plenty of anxious moments to worry about what lies beyond. But it's not as bad as it looks. Keep it straight, and more than likely, you'll find the green. As you walk the course, you can almost see Willie Park walking towards victory in the 1860 Open, scoring 174 over 36 holes. Prestwick hosted the Open 24 times, and what a list of champions. Old Tom Morris, James Braid, and Harry Vardon, who won his record sixth title here in 1914. But most famously, young Tom Morris won the Open here three successive years, 1868, 1869, and 1870. After his third victory, the original prize, the Open Championship belt, became his property. He began the 1870 Open on this spot, which was the location of the original first tee, and what a start he made.
It's quite interesting to know that in 1870, when Tom Morris won the championship for the third time and kept the belt then became his property. He started this hole, which is 578 yards long, with a three. Now, just think about that. You know, he was playing with hickory shafted clubs. He probably didn't hit the ball any further than 180 yards.
The club professionals have made their own history here at Prestwick, but not many have actually held the job. Old Tom Morris was first. Frank Rennie became club professional in 1962. And he's also an honorary life member, a title well earned for his many dedicated years of club service. What an experience it's been. Prestwick is not strictly old-fashioned golf, because even the big hitters here will have to take the drivers out from time to time, especially on the far end of the course. Prestwick still holds up to the best of players and has recently held the amateur championship, but the Open is no longer a possibility. Golfers will have to get by on the memories of old and the chance to play the wonderful 17th. It's called the Ops. It's one of the original holes from that 1860 Open. The tee box directs you to where the pin is located. The three little knobs on top of the Ops correspond to those on the tee box. The hard part is remembering which one was marked. And there's just the odd chance, of course, that the box was marked incorrectly. When you finish this hole, you've had the thrill of playing exactly the same challenge that faced Willie Park, old and young Tom Morris, Harry Vardon and the rest. You know, you're almost home. Aim at the clock on the drivable par 4 18th, just like at St Andrews. Complete your round and then visit the clubhouse. Literally, a museum of golfing history. Prestwick is a friendly and relaxed club, and all visitors are temporary members. The clubhouse is yours to enjoy completely. A full day here is what we recommend, and there's a terrific guest house just across the street, the Golf View Hotel. You'll be pleased with your room and its location, as well as the marvellous service. Prestwick Golf Club. How could you possibly come to Scotland and not visit the birthplace of the Open? If you haven't played it yet, it's time you did. Just a 5-iron from Prestwick is Royal Troon Golf Club, and once a year, the members actually play from one course to the other. Royal Troon, the old clubhouse, the 18th green, and site of so much recent Open Championship glory. Troon, the longest of the Open venues, is championship golf at its finest. Historic, with a spectacular setting against the Firth of Clyde. This is where you find the famous postage stamp, the par 3/8, the shortest hole on the championship rota. This might be the one hole in Scotland you want to play most. You may remember Gene Sarazen's historic ace here when he made his return to the Open in 1973. 50 years after his first visit. Many don't remember he holed out from this bunker right of the green the following day for a birdie too, giving him a par 3 total for 2 days. You can almost picture yourself playing in the Open Championship here at Royal Troon, battling the elements, faithful caddy in tow. It is a marvellous feeling to be out on these links. And by the way, caddies are virtually mandatory to guide you round. They'll thread you between the gorse and trains on the famous 11th, the railway hole, where Jack Nicklaus carded a 10 in his first Open appearance back in 1962. The club's motto is Tam Arti Quam Marti, as much by skill as by strength. Very appropriate. There are long par fours like the 11th and short, tricky par fours like the 7th. Tam Arti Quam Marti, indeed. Great advice for playing Royal Troon. And here's good advice for your accommodation. Stay right next to the course at the Marine Hotel, which is always the R&A headquarters when the Open is held at Royal Troon. But it's more than just a hotel. The Marine has a full leisure centre with a pool and spa and a gym to keep you in shape, which should also be mandatory because there's plenty of fine dining to enjoy. Be sure to make reservations at the hotel's Fairways restaurant overlooking the course. Nearby is Loch Green House, one of the finest restaurants in the West, and also a luxurious country house hotel. With such outstanding accommodation, along with one of the world's most famous courses, Troon has it all. If you ask someone who's made the Scotland circuit which course was their favourite, the answer may surprise you. Western Gales, just a few minutes from Troon, frequently tops the list. Superbly located between the railway and the sea, Western Gales is a glorious championship links where the Curtis Cup has been played. The views are spectacular, with the Isle of Arran just across the Firth of Clyde. Great holes like the long sixth define Western Gales, the serpentine fairway winding its way between the dunes. The seventh is a classic par three. The sea hole, it's called, with a green hidden between a mammoth dune on the left and the beach on the right. You'll want to stay out of this sleeper bunker, by the way, guarding the green. One of the more ominous bunkers you'll find in Scotland. Inside the clubhouse is one of the great locker rooms, the old wood just oozing with history. Upstairs is a golf museum with artifacts and photographs from the club's illustrious past. The cosy members' lounge on the ground floor is a timeless 19th hole. The members are always eager to hear how much you enjoy the course, and you'll enjoy chatting to them too. Across from Western Gales is Glasgow Gales, part of the Glasgow Golf Club, which has its main headquarters in the city. Glasgow Gales is a place for pure Scottish links golf without the multitude of tourists. Though Glasgow Gales is an open final qualifying course, it's slightly held back from more recognition by its location. It's on the wrong side of the track, separated from the sea and reminiscent rather of Royal Lytham and St Anne's in England. However, it is a stern test. Omnipresent gorse and superb bunkering demand pinpoint accuracy from the first to the last. The course set notwithstanding, the Glasgow Golf Club, founded in 1787, is one of the most revered in Scotland. The Victorian clubhouse, built in 1894, is worth the inexpensive green fee by itself. It's a classic 19th hole. The main lounge is particularly special, especially with its original high-arched beam roof. Jacket and tie are necessary in here. Glasgow Gales is very typically Scottish, and it affords an opportunity to play a links passed up by far too many. Between Glasgow and Western Gales is the Gales Lodge, offering fantastic value for money. Comfortable bedrooms, even a penthouse with sauna and jacuzzi, are available for groups that want to spend their money primarily on golf. Close by is the old Lone's Inn, owned by the Gales Lodge, and a good place to pop in for a pint. Prestwick, Troon and Gales, famous open venues. The best final qualifying courses all close together, with little driving necessary. Sounds absolutely ideal. Some of the game's most familiar sites are found on the Ayrshire coast in southwest Scotland. It could only be one place, Turnberry, home of one of the world's great hotels, and one of golf's greatest courses, the Ailsa. The Ailsa was the site of the magnificent duel in the sun between Jack Nicklaus and Tom Watson in the 1977 Open. When you arrive at the starter's hut here, it's true that you're about to walk among the giants. It all starts on the first, a somewhat gentle opener that heads towards the small village. It's not long until you reach the beach and encounter the par 3 fourth. When the winds come off the Firth of Clyde, you might find yourself aiming out to sea. But on gentler days, this appealing hole actually has birdie potential. Turnberry is known for having some of the tallest dunes of all the open venues. Here on the fifth, they create a natural amphitheater, perfect for watching the world's oldest championship. You're getting close to the trademark lighthouse on the sixth, heading right for it, in fact. Soon you're ready to take on the ninth, and its spectacular championship tee, surely one of the world's most exciting. You hit straight over a rocky corner of the Atlantic to a fairway that seems so, so far away. This is the signature spot at Turnberry, though surprisingly the hole is not named for the majestic lighthouse. It's in honor of the castle ruins at its foot. The ninth is known as Bruce's Castle. Robert the Bruce was said to have been born here on July the 11th, 1274, though there are other places that make the same claim. If the great Scottish king was indeed born here, what a view he had when he was growing up. Back on the course, you haven't quite completed the ninth yet. You might end up with a birdie, but a tricky green is its last line of defense. The 15th, a tough par 3 with a deep chasm to the right, was the scene for some vintage Watson heroics in 1977. He holed a nearly impossible putt from off the green. It was, at least 50 feet in length. The 16th is a short par 4 where the wee Wilson Burn guards the green. This beguiling little stream swallows anything that falls short of the green. Beguiling, but also diabolical. Everyone remembers the 18th hole heroics of the 77 Open, but the deciding blow happened on the par 5 17th. Watson birdied, and Nicklaus missed a four-footer to fall behind. And although Jack holed across the green for a birdie at the last, Watson made a birdie too from close range to win. When you finish the ELSA, it's time to head up the hill to the centerpiece of one of the world's finest resorts. A great dinner is in store. Even his bitter defeat in 1977 couldn't stop Nicklaus from dining. You'd gotta eat where he was back then. Before or after dinner, the ELSA Lounge is a great place to meet. You can enjoy a refreshing drink and an equally uplifting view out to ELSA Craig. Late nights can be spent in the billiard room, reminiscent of those rooms in some of the world's most famous houses. The hallmark of this magnificent old hotel are the gorgeous bedrooms. Never underestimate how much time you'll spend in your hotel bedroom. And you know, the bath and the shower are sheer luxury. The suites are the ultimate in comfort. It doesn't get any better. Or maybe it can, because just head downstairs to the spa for some personal pampering. There's also a well-furnished workout room and an indoor pool for a nice swim. Turnberry is the complete resort, to say the least, because other activities include 4x4 off-road driving. Now, there's something you don't expect to do in Scotland. And you can even engage in a spot of falconry. It's not often you get the chance to experience this classic Scottish activity. But Turnberry's real highlights are, of course, of a golfing variety. Visiting golfers are always well looked after here. At the bottom of the hill is a state-of-the-art clubhouse. They designed these lodges specifically to accommodate larger golfing groups of 6 to 16 people for their exclusive use. Across from the clubhouse, in the grounds of the hotel, is one of the finest pitch and putt courses in Scotland. These miniature holes come complete with sod-faced bunkers and are great fun as you hone your golfing skills of an evening. Turnberry now has a second championship course, the Kintyre, which brings the newly acquired coastline on the other side of the lighthouse into play. Designed by Donald Steele, it's itself an open final qualifying venue. The Kintyre is laid on top of what was the original Arran course, an old-fashioned layout that was carved through the gorse. Donald Steele transformed it into a links of high acclaim, incorporating additional features like this snaky burn on the first. One hole you'll certainly remember is the 8th, a 280 yards par 4 heading straight to the sea with the green nowhere in sight. Ah, wait a minute, there it is. The terrain drops off sharply down by the water, and the green is near sea level at the base of the white pole. It's one of the great green locations you'll ever play, and justifiable reason to have a round at Kintyre while staying at Turnberry. Another reason to visit is the chance to delve into Turnberry's non-golfing history. It was used as an RAF base during two world wars, and remnants of the old airplane runways are visible throughout the Kintyre course. The 18th on Kintyre caps 36 holes of sensational golf at Turnberry. In between rounds, make the short trip up the road to visit Killeen Castle, which President Dwight D. Eisenhower visited on numerous occasions. He had his own apartment there, and if you like, you can even stay in it today. Think of the Turnberry Lighthouse as a beacon, calling golfers to this heaven on earth in southwest Scotland. It's not inexpensive, but the life experience is well worth a small premium. So do yourself a favor. Spend at least a few days at Turnberry.